For the people who may be visiting today, I've been working on a series of messages on prophecy, prophetic themes, and I'll be continuing on that today and in the weeks to come as the Lord leads me in that. Recently, I heard something, and apparently it's been around for a couple of years, really troubled me, in that some school in the state of North Carolina, and I think also in Nebraska, in Lincoln, Nebraska, where there was literature circulated among the teachers of those schools that it would be better if they no longer called the students in their classroom boys or girls. And I suppose some of you've heard that. I don't know where I'd been. I had not heard that until just the last couple of weeks again, that thing has sort of caught hold in our country, so that when you're talking in the school or wherever, don't call them boys or girls. It has to be gender neutral. Well, and I don't mean to make light. I'm sure sometimes the way we're raised, we have things that we're mixed up about. But I'm here to tell you that when I grew up, I was a boy. And part of the time, I still feel like a boy. And I see a hand raised back there. You know, praise the Lord. And I think that most of you ladies here today, growing up, you were called girls. And I realize that sometimes genes get mixed up, and we'll blame that on Adam when he sinned in the Garden of Eden. A lot of our problems happened and began in the Garden of Eden. But I know that when Moses was put in that little box in the River Nile or wherever it was there in Egypt, he was a boy, and he stayed a boy and grew up to be a man. You know, looking at Jesus' meeting with Satan in the wilderness, this is what Satan said in Luke 4, verses 5 and 6. And this is, we call, where Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. Then the devil, taking him up on a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, "All this authority I will give you and their glory, for this has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish." I believe that that simply means that at a certain time in the history of men, that God allowed and still allows David to have control of the nations of this world under God's authority and by God's permission. And so the devil says to the Lord Jesus, "All this authority I'll give to you if you will fall down and worship me, because it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I want to." And I believe that any president, any ruler of a country, if he allows himself to be controlled by the devil himself, then the devil takes full control of that country. I think we have a problem with that in our country. I'm not saying anything about Trump necessarily. For your information, I like what he's doing. I didn't think that he was a good candidate, but I like it, some of the things that he's doing. John 13, 27, this verse tells us that Satan entered Judas. Now, after the piece of bread, he took the piece of bread, Judas did, and he dipped it in the container that Jesus had there, and as soon as he did, Scripture tells us that Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, "What you do, do quickly." In other words, he was going to betray Jesus. And he said, get it done with, because it's in your heart to do that. Judas was never a true believer, never. He was a disciple. He was called by Jesus himself to fulfill Scripture, but he was never a true believer. And when he betrayed Jesus, that was in his heart. He had chosen to do that. Ephesians 2:2 tells us that Satan is the prince of the power of the air, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. I believe the scripture teaches us when you become a believer, whenever that is in your life, it could be when you're 5 years older, you put your trust in Jesus Christ. It could be like this last week, no credit to me, but I was speaking to a lady, 94 years old. She accepted Jesus Christ as her Savior in my presence. That's waiting a long time to become a believer. And when you accept Jesus as your Savior, the Spirit of God comes into your life and He desires to control your life. If you do not have the Spirit of God in your life, if you do not have Jesus in your life, this verse tells you that Satan, the spirit, he now works in you. It's a spirit of disobedience. Now, Satan is the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in our world. And he is attempting to control the whole world. There is coming a day when our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior from sin, is going to reclaim the world unto himself and kick Satan out of his position of authority. And that day is coming. It may be coming sooner than we expected, when Jesus will reclaim the kingdoms of the world unto himself. One day he will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. One day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Philippians chapter 5, Revelation 19, 16. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's when he comes riding upon a white horse with the armies of heaven, which will be the church of Jesus Christ, who has been called up into heaven at the rapture. They will return along with the saints of the Old Testament with the Lord Jesus, leading them on his white horse into the great conflict of Armageddon, spoken of in Revelation chapter 16 and verse 19, and chapter 19 as well. And he will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords. At the battle of Armageddon, the beast, that's the Antichrist, the beast, the ruler of the one world government, and the false prophet, the chief authority of the one world church. Let me take a moment to talk to you again about that. That was my sermon last Sunday. Just a little bit of review. Apparently, during the tribulation period, which is a period of 7 years, there will be two great forces during that time. At the beginning of that period, all believers, all Christians will have been called to heaven. They will have been caught away at the rapture, and then the great tribulation period begins. No believers to begin with. You know, I think some people take comfort in the fact, you know, if I don't become a Christian now, if I don't give my heart to the Lord, in the day in which we live. I can just sort of wait until the Great Tribulation period, and then I can become a Christian. I'll still have time. Don't count on it, friends. Don't count on it. I think 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I don't have that in my message this morning, but if you get home today, open your Bible to 2 Thessalonians 2, where I think it tells us that our hearts will be hardened. If you're not a believer, your heart will be hardened, and you will gladly take the mark of the beast, the Antichrist, with the number 666. I may not understand all of the complications of that, but friends, if God speaks to you today and you're not a believer, open your heart to Him. In that great musical, and especially the Hallelujah Chorus, written by Handel, I believe, what a wonderful song, where in that song, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord Jesus Christ, and He shall reign forever. Now, let's take a quick trip through Matthew chapter 13, and it's going to be very quick. I'll have it up on the screen, but notice what it says. The kingdom of heaven, listen carefully, in our time, is a mystery kingdom. I'm going to say it again. The kingdom in our time is a mystery kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. The parable of the sower, Matthew 13:3. Then He spoke many things to them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went out to sow. Brief summary. The word of God fell on four kinds of soil. The parable of the sower, four kinds of soil. My conviction is that two of those kinds of soil, hearts that received the word of God, but it didn't make any impression on them, but only for a moment. The third and fourth kind of soils, perhaps we're believers, I know that the fourth kind of soil is when the word of God is taught and it falls on people's hearts and minds. As it is today, the word of God is being given. It comes into your heart, and the question is, do you trust it? Do you believe it? Do you commit your life to it? Do you say it's worthwhile? I will embrace the Word of God. I will embrace Jesus Christ. I will accept Him as my Savior. The fourth kind of soil, no question about it, it falls on good soil and it bears fruit. Not sure about the third kind of soil. Maybe we'll talk about that at some other point. But notice chapter 13 and verse 3. He spoke many things to them in parables, saying, A sower went out to sow. That's happening in the age in which we live. The second parable is the parable of the wheat and the tares. Matthew chapter 13. And he sowed, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds devoured came and devoured them. Let's look at verse 24, fellows upstairs. Matthew 13:24. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. Next verse. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. Two kinds of seeds in churches. There's wheat, and there's tares. When a man gets up and says from the pulpit, we accept all kinds of people in our church. And I want to make clear again, I don't care if you're a homosexual or a lesbian, you are welcome in our church. You're welcome. If you're a transgender, you're welcome at St. Paul's. If you're a fornicator, you're welcome in our church. If you are an adulterer, you're welcome at St. Paul's. There is no person who is not welcome in our church. If you're black, you're welcome. If you're brown, you're welcome. If you're yellow, you're welcome. If you're white, you're welcome. Every kind of person is welcome. But you are not welcome to be a member of this church until you become a believer. Understand what I'm saying? Then you're welcome. You're welcome. Churches should be made up of true believers. But while men slept, the parable of the wheat and the tares, while men slept, tares crept into the church and have filtered into the church and have corrupted the church. And this is why you have in our time the great conflict about lesbians, homosexuals, transgender. Great conflict. God loves those people. Jesus died to save their soul. But those people who do not repent, and I speak kindly about that, I remember having two young males, 15 years old, 14, 16. I was troubled one day when one of those young fellows who had homosexual tendencies came and talked to me, and he said to me, "Pastor, I'm attracted to you." Man, you talk about a pastor having weird feelings. To have some young guy, a teenager, say, "I'm physically attracted to you." "What course should I take?" I said to him, "You know, you and I are going to sit down. We're going to study the Word of God together. We're going to pray about this problem, because that is, maybe you feel that way, but it's abnormal." Another fellow in the same church said this. He didn't say those words to me, but I met with both of those young men, prayed with them, studied the Word of God together with them, tried to direct them right. They both are married. They both have children. They both have left that kind of feelings and lifestyle behind them. But the devil plants tares in churches, and churches begin to drift. We have a lot of churches in our time which have drifted away from the Word of God. I trust that St. Paul's will not drift away from the Word of God. And my desire as a pastor, as long as I'm here, is to teach and to preach the Word of God. The parable of the grain and mustard seed, Matthew chapter 13, verses 31. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man looked and sowed in his field. Even though it's the smallest of seeds, it grew into something large." Christianity, as far as I know, is the largest spiritual group in the world. It has more members. It has grown to a huge group of people. Now, I know that there are a lot of Muslims. I know that there are a lot of Buddhists. I know that there are a lot of Hindus. But I think in terms of numbers, people would identify themselves as Christians more than anyone else. And I can't give you the exact number. If one of you know, let me know. Listen, folks, just remember, and I can't put a number on it, I know that in the Old Testament, God always had his remnant. The people that went into the wilderness and crossed the Red Sea, many of those people were unbelievers, and they corrupted the Word of God during their time of 40 years in the wilderness. They corrupted the Word of God. And many of them were not true believers. And so God has always had a, and I don't want to make light or little the church in small numbers. I think someone told me that the churches in our country, by and large, only average 60 to 80 people in most churches. We hear about the churches that have a couple of them in Dallas, Texas, that have 30, 40,000 people. And I happen to know, I kind of feel good about this. I started in a little church in LaGrange, and the pastor that was before me Kurt Lehman, and he was a good preacher, a good pastor. He went to Lincoln, Nebraska, and started a Berean church. It is the largest church in Nebraska. But he preached the Word of God. God blessed his ministry. And we stopped in there a couple of years ago, and the church was full. And I asked the people, how many people do you minister to in a week? He said, the person that told me said 6,000 or 7,000 people, about the largest church in Nebraska, but it's a Bible teaching church. But the parable of the mustard seed, it is the least of all seeds, and when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air refer to ungodly people who do not really love God. The birds of the air come and nest in its branches. That's evil teaching in the church. What am I saying? Matthew chapter 13 gives us a bird's eye view of what the kingdom of heaven is like in the period in which we live. The parable of the leaven, chapter 13, verse 33. Notice what it says. Another parable he spoke to them, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal till it was all leavened. Sometimes evil is like leaven in a church, and it fills the doctrine of the church. Again, I repeat, used to attend a Mennonite church. 40 people were kicked out of the church because they believed that the devil himself would eventually be saved. Parable of the leaven, evil which infiltrates the church. The fifth parable, the parable of treasure, chapter 13, verse 44. Notice what it says. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid, and for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. This is, excuse me, folks, I'm giving it my own interpretation. Go home and study it for yourself. In the Old Testament, the people of Israel, the Jewish people, were always known as God's treasure. In the church of our time, the Lord's church, the body of Christ, you have both Jews, people of Israel, God's treasure. You have Gentiles who become Christians, that's the church. You have Jews and Gentiles, read it from the book of Ephesians, they are both in the same body, the body of Christ. And so, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in the field. You have Jews who have become Christians and belong to the church. Let's look at Exodus 19 and verse 4. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. That's the New King James. I read it different than the King James. Let's go to Psalm 135, verse 4. For the Lord has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel for his special treasure. The sixth parable in Matthew 13 is the parable of the pearl, chapter 13, verses 45 and 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, verse 46, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. That's a picture of Jesus Christ giving everything that he ever had. He gave his life, he shed his blood, in order that he might purchase the pearl of great price. That's the church. He purchased us with his own blood. And then last of all, the seventh parable, the parable of the net, chapter 13, verses 47 through 52. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age, the angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into a furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Jesus said to them, "Have you understood all these things?" They said to him, "Yes, Lord." Then he said to them, "Therefore, every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things old and new." Let me try and summarize very quickly. Matthew chapter 13 gives the parables of the kingdom of heaven, seven of them. They are a picture of what the visible church would look like in this age in which we live. At the end of this age, all true Christians will be raptured into heaven, and the 7 years of tribulation begin, and the 7 years of tribulation accomplishes two things. Number one, the Gentile nations of the world will be judged for their wickedness. The Jewish people will, for the first time as a nation and as a people, will open their arms wide to the true Messiah, Jesus Christ. And at the Battle of Armageddon, and I would prefer to call it the conflict of Armageddon, when the armies of heaven, led by Jesus on his white horse, and the people raptured and the Old Testament saints gather together with Jesus Christ and do battle against the Antichrist at the end of the age in the conflict of Armageddon, and with Jesus riding on his white horse, labeled on his horse, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he will reclaim the earth, and it will be under his authority during the thousand-year reign of Jesus Christ. I'm sorry I have to cut my message short. I'll finish in a later Sunday. So as I close, conclusion, let me ask you the question as I ask myself, what does all this have to do with me? How should I react to all of this? Let's look at Luke 21:28, just a couple of verses as I close. "Now when these things begin to happen, look up and lift up your head, because your redemption draws near." I need to be aware of what's happening in the day in which we live. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 14. "Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless." How should the second coming, how should the end of the age, how should the great tribulation period affect me? I want to be a person that will be found in him, by him, in peace, without spot and blameless. The only way you can be found that way is by having Jesus Christ come into your life, removing your sin, and you stand perfect before him. Mark chapter 4 and verse 19. Tremendous verse. What is it that keeps people from being the kind of people they should be, of becoming Christians? "And the cares of this world," not a person here today who doesn't have the cares of this world. We have all kinds of problems. Raising a family, making a living, resisting temptation, all of the problems. The cares of this world fill our life. We are filled with some tenacious problems. Cares of this world, deceitfulness of riches, I often think. I'm not a rich person, but guess what? God has provided every need that I have ever needed. I remember going to the University of Oklahoma. I was never hungry. I only ate one meal a day, but I was never hungry. He supplied all of my needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus. but the deceitfulness of riches. I should hold on to the riches that I have loosely, because they can disappear in a moment of time. The deceitful insertion and the desires for other things. You know what I've always wanted? A Harley. If I could only have a Harley. And by the way, I have enough money right now, and we're not rich. I could go out and buy a Harley. It might be a $2,000 Harley, but I could buy one. And boy, I'd open that thing up and go down the road. But guess what? The desires for other things enter in and choke the Word of God, and I become unfruitful. The deceitfulness of riches, the cares of this world, and the desire for other things choke the Word of God in my life, and I become unfruitful. So as we close today, how does my life and how does your life measure up to God's will for my life? That's the question. Well, we're going to sing a verse of invitation. Let's stand together as we sing. Words will be up on the screen.